Well, we're just now after the performance.
Okay.
And I'm particularly moved because you created ecosystems of daydreams, which mean to me so much because when I was a child and I started composing, because I loved pieces which moved me, and I was thinking remotely that one day perhaps somebody will play my music and it would mean to this person what the pieces I play from other composers mean to me. I would like to tell you also that I was very impressed with the preparation and the handout and the examples, and I feel I become theory paper with the excerpts of the scores, and I appreciated very much the fact that you described some stylistic facts. And then comes the moment to play. So Soojin, I would like you to tell me a little bit more about simply the inspiration of learning one of the pieces.
Actually, most of his inspiration came from the recital that I attended that you gave in the 2014. And especially I like the pieces in the Music in a Child's World because, I mean, all the harmonies and colors really speak to me very meaningfully. So it was very enjoyable to learn, actually. And you used to say that you're very sorry to compose like just very sophisticated pieces, but I mean, I really enjoyed performing and practicing and preparing it. So
I can imagine how hard that was because the texture of linear layers.
Oh, that is true.
Of performing without it appearing to be obliterating the very emotional meaning is something which I try to do by voicing, and I noticed in your playing, since I didn't hear you prepare the program, since I wasn't allowed, I appreciated your softness of touch, and you managed to find layers under that softness. Now, you say that you heard them at the recital where I played of them. I would like to imagine what you think once you start practicing it on the score and you become the other composer on the other side of the book, which is the performer. As they say, a book has two authors, the author and the reader.
Oh, sure. So reader somehow participates in another level of creating the piece. Or
I think participates in creating the piece because the music doesn't speak by the paper.
Sure.
But the paper, and I must say that I have an amazing engraver who manages to give this most beautiful, intelligent eye-to-notes approach. Mm-hmm. And especially when the textures become very even almost confusingly complex. Yao manages to make it always transparent. But the fact is that you studied them as a piece from the score. When I study a piece from the score, and you too from other composers, we've heard it around. But then once we start playing it and we read it, we see differently. How did that happen for you? For instance, when you started learning the piece, did you think, it's more than I thought I heard in his recital?
Ah.
Or less? Or differently? Or it doesn't come out the same?
It doesn't come out the same at all, actually. Generally, I was incredibly inspired by any pieces that you played in the recital. And I was expecting those kind of sound coming from me when I started to play these pieces. But when I learned and when I tried to perform it, it was totally different because I couldn't somehow manage to make that soft sound and the different layers of the tones and harmonies. And especially what was very hard is, let's say, because of the lack of horizontal listening ability, it was very hard for me to follow each voice as it is. But I often tend to play all those voices at the same time simultaneously as a chord or as a harmony. So when I learned it, I didn't know how to voice it the horizontally. So probably I think that was the main difference between your playing and my playing. It was incredible. I thought when I started to learn it in the first place, it was really fragmented.
When I hear a piece that I love, I always think, but not that it's lack of humility, it's just more like hope to do. I should have written that piece.
Ah.
Just because it touches all the essential points of what music means to me. Mm-hmm. And then when I hear you play today a piece which I imagined and I played, as you heard, before you chose it to play today, I heard it today differently. Mm. And I was thankful to the writing, because without the score texture, there's nothing else left. That's all we have between the dead composers and today from whom we don't have recordings. And as a teacher, you know how much I struggle to think, what did the composer want? And when the composer plays, I think the composer is not obviously the best performer just because he's the composer.
Not necessary all the time. I mean, have you heard that Rachmaninoff plays his concerto? Mm. That's his better performer, so to say.
Except that there is a transmission of some things that are not palpable. For instance, there is a level of emotion in some of Rachmaninoff's themes that in his playing he refuses to translate.
Intentionally?
I don't know, I wasn't there. Okay. But it always surprised me. Mm-hmm. It seems to me like composing often to me is like memorizing a piece that hasn't yet existed. And you just literally bring it out of you. And then it becomes a score, and then somebody plays it like it existed. Always think, oh, there must have been a day before the Schumann Fantasy and the day after the Schumann Fantasy was written. And to me, it's impossible to think the world without. When my children were born, I told them, there is something fantastic. The day you were born, you always existed. When factually they didn't. But to me, this kind of completude and emptiness at the same time of the universe and what we are in it, it's only the intentions. Imagine if you have to describe a sunset to a born blind. It's very difficult. Because in fact, certain things only the senses can bring to understand. And I think that to a certain extent, that's the problem with interpretation, is that it's in the eye of the beholder. If it means something to you and is differently meaning than for me, as long as it means something for you, for me it's marvelous. Because it means like I passed by for the few years of parenthesis of my life through the eternity of times, and I left something that perhaps will mean something to somebody. In this case, you met me because I was your teacher. But perhaps it might mean something, perhaps to a student of yours in 40 years.
So true.
And perhaps they'll watch this and think, teacher looks so young. But the truth is that it's a very nice feeling to attend to this kind of out-of-body experience for a composer who usually is not around.
But I know sometimes the composer really, if anybody plays any contemporary music, I heard many stories, the composer really do the microsurgery on every single note, that piece to be played, what exactly he wanted. And I was a little bit worried in the first place, if that case is your case. But I wouldn't think like that, but I mean, what if you don't like the way I interpret? That wasn't one of the problems that I was
on. I think that I have myself premiered pieces of living composers, and I like to tell them I feel better when they're not around.
What does mean there?
Meaning I feel more free to play the sections of the pieces that I love of theirs without their supervision. And in a way, I think it's very important for a composer to accept that that daydream storytelling doesn't belong to the composer. Once it's composed, it belongs to whoever wants to like it, share it, dance it, paint it, sing it. Your touch was so subtle today, I thought you painted more than you played, like Impressionism. I was thinking, I personally wouldn't play like that. I would play some sections more forcefully. But I found that this aspect gave a beautiful revelation to me of what the piece is too. And I still think that the only reason we do something is desire. And the only reason we keep doing something is because of the desire. So the interpretation, the right of the wrong, the authentic from the non-authentic, all these are scholar things which have their value in terms of academia. But in terms of playing, when Rubinstein plays Chopin, nobody cares which edition he uses. Because he sounds authentic by his charisma. And one can like or not, but the evidence is that Madame Argerich is very convincing when she plays the piano because she has fun doing things that most of us struggle.
That is true.
And so, it's not. And when we think that Mozart composed things in 20 minutes, which might take us 20 years, we are in disbelief. Again, we're in front of this disbelief of time. And I would like to say that when I hear you play, for instance, when you started the program, you played that Autumn Tale. Mm-hmm. And I noticed that you kept the pedal in a way that it connected to the next harmony a little bit, like wet eyes looking at the horizon line.
Oh, that actually, I wanted it to be that way because I thought these harmonies were better sounded when it is blended. Rather having clear five different harmonies, if you somehow overlap the sound of it, I thought it was more meaningful to me, because that's what Autumn...
That's why I said you're on the other side of the book, the other composer, when you play it.
Ah.
Because it can be as convincing, in my opinion, without that. Some people think it's too much rubato for Chopin, and some people think it's not enough because there is no objective criteria. Tipsy or drunk? Hint or an exaggeration? And whose culture is what? The way you displayed the opening chords sounded to me like a sort of a harp. I can see myself.
Okay.
I remember the.
Ah.
It's not to contradict you, it's just say that that was my original imagination, but as if it's to say that the parent is the only person who understands the child. Obviously, there are the teachers, and obviously, there are the spouses, because the child evolves.
Oh.
And this 78 born child, since he was composed then, he's now an old man. To me, it's the 15-year-old me. Because you were not born when I wrote it. And that amused me a lot in my seat. Example now and not before, because I don't want to interject in the connection that you have between what the daydream of the inspiration brings you to. It has nothing to do with being picky or not picky. It's thinking that perhaps if it means something to you and is different than to me, it's only better.
Really?
Yeah. I find myself almost surprised that this piece is so old.
Oh, well, it was composed in 1878.
No, 1978.
Oh, yeah, 1978.
Not that old. Not even have been Brahms.
Yeah.
But seriously.
Mm.
And to me, it's as striking as a student coming to want to play Brahms or Chopin, and when it's all about longing, expecting, all the European 19th century in terms of what we call romanticism, and you live today at a paced world, clicking and clinking and all these things. So the very idea of the romanticism with the, what is the ecosystem of Chopin outside of his time zone? What would have been the thoughts of Mozart if he was asked what would be played 250 years or 300 years later? He probably would have thought that people will play the composer of the day. But unfortunately, somehow the classical music, common language, adaptable to all, and recognizable by so many. It's almost like the difference between state and nation. The nations become states, and some states are before they are a nation. I think the styles adapt to the tonal system, and the tonal system allows to be adapted by the different styles, so that Bach, Chopin, and Schumann don't sound the same, while they use strictly the same grammar.
Mm.
And so therefore, the person who can read this language that is common to so many styles has access to all of these emotionally and intellectually. And then after Schoenberg, it was polytonal, posttonal, serial, neoclassical, microtonal, and it's almost like as if you need to learn the language of a composer in order to understand the composer. Which is very lacking universality.
That is true.
And I think if one is convinced that one needs to change the language, one is a Beethoven. And if one needs to just prolong the conversation from the teacher, one is a Mozart compared to Haydn. And so I would say, my teacher, Mademoiselle Boulanger, used to say, you don't have to always need to change things if you find the tools of expression in the alphabet that you're given. And Schubert and until Liszt, basically Ravel included, didn't need it. If they did, they would have. So the style you mentioned in your explanation and the techniques of composing were not at all what made me compose.
Oh, sure, sure.
And for some, composition is something more like a crossword puzzle or a very interesting Sudoku game or chess or mathematics at very high level, and that's fine too. But it was never what appealed to me. What appealed to me is the emotion I felt in a Schubert song, in a Mozart aria.
So you use this kind of tool to bring out what you felt?
Well, because it came to a point where I either should stop to compose, either should throw my scores in the Seine River, which many, many composers did in France, like Duparc, except the few songs that were the publisher that we can have today. He dumped everything in the Seine River, thinking it wasn't worth it. Oh. It's a very difficult gesture to understand, but I think in a way it's a very cleansing gesture too. And Mademoiselle Boulanger never encouraged me to be this or that style. She taught me to be for myself, in my work, without any understanding, always never accepting anything but perfection, and if not, not to leave anything. But from others to accept everything. So she didn't oblige me to compose like Fauré because it was her teacher, or like Stravinsky because in many ways they had influence on each other in the 30s. Of course, I did get some influence of that, but it wasn't something I was searching for, nor I was escaping from. I was just evolving. And she was strict for all things academic, as she asked me to be strict with myself. But she was very freeing for everything creative.
That's when she allowed Piazzolla to compose a tango, something like
she
that.
Suggested that he works on his own folkloric music with her. And with me, it was a very interesting, refreshing moment because during the time I studied with her in Paris was a dictatorship of avant-garde. Boulez and all these famous names were imposing the music of the future, which was everything but tonal. And I must say that my teacher was able to teach me at a very early age the difference between forbidden and tolerated.
Ah.
So if it's forbidden in a harmony exercise to do parallel fifths, uh-huh. it's because it teaches you how to find a creative way of voice leading, so you become a contrapuntal writer just because you're obliged to think in contrary motion rather than parallel motion, which makes you write everything on root positions. So basically it's more like developing your intellect. And when you played the later pieces of mine today, I was very impressed because I like the idea that you hear colors.
I thought it was very obvious for anybody to play your music. It was just really full of colors, and I felt it when I learned it, so I was trying to bring it out today.
And when you had this enormously And Mademoiselle Boulanger would have been very proud of you. Moment of humility, telling the audience that you're not ready technically to play the prelude with the two hands.
Yeah.
I thought that was a very humble thing to do because it was an easy thing to say.
Well, yeah, but at the same time, I wanted to tell them, if you want to improve your technique, also this piece can be a very good opportunity to develop their...
Well, because the style was not imposed, and I was decided to continue composing,
sure,
even if I don't compose avant-garde.
Sure.
Then I decided I will write what is coming through my fingers.
Mm-hmm.
Because on the table, I imagine things when I try on the piano they don't sound like. I imagine them. And again, when Yao is engraving the preludes for the two hands, I remember she telling me, who's the pianist who will play trill in the same hand as an aria? Especially if the trill is in the top part with 4-5 or 4-3. And it's true. You could think if the piece is justified by its difficulty, it's almost a wrong justification. I like to think that the difficulty is only in order to reach the level of expression. When you play a Chopin sonata, it is difficult, but once you learn it, it becomes meaningful. And so I like to think, or hope, that some of my pieces will be played as you did today for what they are. And when you think that you're not ready to play them and you said it, I thought it was very courageous. I almost think that when you displayed the melody, and the right hand prelude, together. Is it the complexity that matters, or the emotion of the trill as a shaking, and the chord as a pounding of the time passing, and the melody as the destiny? And the melody on the top trying to survive this chaos of nature. It will be cheesy. But I don't think it needs to be said in words.
If it's said in the word, that somehow I think limits the various interpretational choices which performer can pick. So I think it's rather not mentioned.
Does that happen to you when you think of Les Adieux by Beethoven?
Oh, not necessarily. That kind of helps me to have a certain idea.
Separation?
Yes.
Absence?
Yes.
And then rejoicing return?
Yes.
Isn't that eternal? You don't think of your own life when you play it?
Oh, somehow.
Or do you think of storytelling in pieces that don't have one?
I do, actually. I do.
That's what I told you today. I discovered
I
your ecosystem of daydreaming.
Yeah, I do, actually.
Look, and you open again the print. Change. Again. It almost feels like it should be a piece that is played perpetually.
Ah. minimalism style?
Like the left hand version, the right hand version, the two hands version, and again.
Ah.
Because I think that the collision of the elements perhaps is too much to absorb for a listener the first time.
Yeah. Ah.
Which touches to the point of how emotionally direct the music is and how complex it becomes when you write it.
Mm.
You mentioned that I am at many improvisations daily.
Yes. But 4,500.
It doesn't matter, there could be one or 1,100. But the point is that they are ephemeral thoughts. Mm. And when you notate a thought, you start is when you reread yourself, adding something, reorganizing something. In other words, the first inspiration is filtered by the brain. And I try to hope that when my music evolves in time, since I started composing, the first pieces my father took on solfège dictation from the recording device.
Ah.
And now, I can say that he was the person who allowed me to practice my compositions as other person's pieces because I had the score handwritten by him. And then Mademoiselle Boulanger, during my studies with her, didn't want me to improvise because she wanted me to structure my thinking process as a composer. Since my creative flow never stops. Or she would have said sometimes, if you don't like how Beethoven wrote that sonata, learn to play it like he did want, and if you really want to do something, write your own.
And you started to write on your own.
I never shied. But in fact, it's all part of the same story. Like, the fact that the music is written is just to transmit. And I must say that the transmission of your playing today touched me a lot.
Thank you so much.
But you know, it's mostly interesting because you concluded with a paragraph which was very personal and which I used for another composer.
Oh.
And you didn't know that because we never prepared this recital together since I wasn't allowed to do so by the laws. It's Jean Francais.
Oh.
And when Jean Francais died, I remember I said, you know, his music is like he was. So perhaps to a certain extent, when a composer is naturally, intensely sincere in the expression, of course, the act of writing a piece is bigger than one's own life. But it is part of it too, captured in the essence. Just like the powder that's left after we die and we're cremated. In a way, it's that kind of universality. And I think that when you said that you can go to his office and speak to him, or you can listen to his music and speak to his, or play through his music, that's very touching to me because I think it's a prolonging way. Mm. And of course, most people, you for instance, never met Jean Francais. So if I tell you his music is like he was, you would say so. Since I didn't meet him, I don't know how Rachmaninoff was as a person compared to his music. We know the recording, how he played it. We don't know how Beethoven was, etc. We extrapolate. Now, I would like to conclude this thank you by asking you to play the opening section of the middle, the heartland of the parfum.
Okay, sure.
De l'âme. is no more me. And I'm next to you. And if you play it after me, I will still be next to you. Sometimes I play, not that my teacher only composed, because she didn't a lot, but even if it's related to her because it's a beloved piece like the Requiem by Fauré or something of her own, inevitably, because I was her student like you are mine, I have a sense of gratitude for what I received, which I understand is very not obvious, because sometimes it doesn't happen, but I appreciate it every time when it does. And in this case, way beyond, in the sense that it's the essence of the music making of me as a composer and not me as the teacher. But nevertheless, while I play, for instance, there is this video, of rare video footage of me as a child playing the Mozart Fantasy.
Oh, yeah.
And Mademoiselle Boulanger sitting next to me, and she holds my hand. Exactly. So when I play it in concert, inevitably, I even today think of her being around me. And I think that the piano as an instrument is powerful enough to emulate so many genres that, in a way, it's a machine to go back in time and to travel in another dimension. Because I find that's true for everything. If you're a historian or a scholar, you enter in focusing on research on a given topic, you start being in it. And I find that very fascinating, and I'm very thankful that you took the time to enter in my musical world as a composer. And I'm very honored. I will tell the composer.
Please do so.
That I enjoyed myself very much. Mm-hmm. And when you started playing Las Prisas to conclude the recital, I stood up on the last row and I started dancing by myself.
Oh.
To the dismay of the audience members who were looking at me like as if I was out of my mind.
Oh, I didn't know.
Because you mentioned rightfully that it's canta baila.
Yeah.
And the baila part with the... And the that would be a challenge on the Bösendorfer. No matter how large the keyboard isn't large enough for my expression.
Oh, that is so true.
But the truth is that my father, who was my first musical mentor by association, because his mother was a solfège teacher, and notated on dictation my first improvised compositions, and I was six.
Was it?
Yeah, that's very Bulgarian,
yeah.
Folkloric. Yeah. See, immediately the instrument played and we travel in time. I'm back in 1970, 68 rather, in Sofia on my upright. So it is true that when I was in Spain, I was very impressed how much the folkloric music of theirs is part of their culture. Again, nation and state is not the same. And France, for instance, was a state before it became a nation. So it doesn't have a unity of folklore in music. It has only regions at most. And this very strong component in Spanish music, in Greek music, in Bulgarian music exists, but mostly because popular music was danced or sung and transmitted so, not written. And I must say that I felt like the best interpretation I could do of Defaya or of Albéniz or of Granados piece is to write my own Spanish piece.
So here we go, Las Brisas.
Las Brisas.
Yeah. Yeah. Actually, when I was playing that piece, I was actually really enjoying it. Because I felt, I don't know, it was incredibly festive. When I started the very first note, just immediately I got into that mood of the full of festive. So I really enjoyed it, playing that part.
In the evenings after the classes, they all gather outside the cafes and they talk to each other like birds in the flock.
Like birds?
And they don't listen to each other because they constantly talk all at the same time. So
are they okay to understand what they are saying?
Originally, I was not even able to understand how that functions. But in fact, when I was teaching the Spanish composers then, I discovered that they transcribed in music that exact fact. Mm. That constant
busyness,
yes.
That's what I had in the Albanese music too, actually.
So then, of course, environment predestines a certain type of being. And if you're born in Norway or in southern Spain, obviously you have a different ear for music, just like the mother tongue you received from your mother was Korean before you knew how to write. And a composition to me is like a mother tongue. It comes out of you because it's not written yet. It just comes as sounds. And then you find in the reverse engineering how to write sounds that correspond to what other people will start from the text on, like a second language. But you start it usually as grammar and drills and vocabulary, rather than just by ear. The only language you study, in fact you don't study, is the mother tongue. But you learn it the only way, which is by oral transmission, before you learn how to write it later. And I think the energy of the folkloric aspect of music is also because of that transmission. Bartok already tested it when he tried to notate it in the Balkanic mountains. Yeah. And the problem is that if you mix up too much of the people's influence and then the elite studies, it becomes almost undigestible food. It's almost like as if you have a grandmother who knows how to cook because of how she was taught by her grandmother, or you have a scientist who's cooking you the same food out of the ingredients. And sometimes the know-how is not so much in the else than in this kind of proportions that come out of the experience. And I find that interpretation is really, as you proved it today, a way to bring the music alive. And the music on the score is just a way to connect it to the next generation. As my friend in Paris Conservatoire used to say, the text was here before us and the text will be here after us. But while we are in front of the text, it's ours. And I was very deeply moved that it was yours this evening.
Thank you. I liked it, actually. You used to say that it's very hard to practice and perform it. And of course I practiced it a lot.
But memorize it.
Yes, I memorized it. But I mean, actually after I memorized it, it became much more enjoyable.
When you close your eyes, you play by heart. And I think the expression comes from the soul that is supposed to be the heart, symbolically.
Yeah.
And I think that's what it is, that once you're you've learned the text, you appropriate it. Therefore, you play it by heart and not only by memory, which obviously is through the memory. But in fact, that's why I said composing is writing something that hasn't been written yet. Therefore, it somehow exists in you diffusely. So in a way, it's memorizing ahead. And that's why it's so important to appreciate that it could mean whatever it does, even if it's different from my own. And when it's so beautifully inspired as you're playing today.
Thank you.
Thank you very much,
Soojin. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.